infrastructure and IT management at Rabobank. I've had some insight into this, or some preview of this presentation. I'm looking forward to it. Toine is a broadly skilled IT manager known for a pragmatic approach and getting the job done. In his career, he's held positions as lead operations architect, project manager, product manager, department manager, and ITIL process manager. Toine is active as the chairman of Interexperience Netherlands and is a member of the Global Customer Advisory Council for HP Enterprises. And this morning, Toine will explain how IT4IT helps his organization navigate the DevOps journey. So a warm welcome, please, for Toine.
I just got my water out of the way. After last night, maybe I need it. We did some singing in the lobby here with a few people. So, the clicker. I'm going to tell you the story about what we're doing at Rabobank and why. Well, when we started, roughly, what we did, where we're going, and based on the business strategy. So how business strategy and IT strategy, we try to align it. We see, as we have all very happy customers, everybody's very happy with banking at the moment. So in the Netherlands, it's the same thing. We see we don't have any security attacks or that kind of stuff. So in the end, we don't have problems. But still, actually, in the Netherlands, we created a tidal wave last week by announcing that 25% of our people have to go. We have to cut 25% of our cost. So this is strongly related to how, from IT perspective, we are going to do that. First of all, and I will click on. First of all, I will introduce our bank. We are we have a global presence, coming from agriculture background. We are founded by farmers. We are actually still in the agricultural and food business, and we try to be a player across the world in agricultural and food, and a retail player in the Netherlands for mortgages and loans. To get an idea of our IT, we have roughly in our business, we have 45,000 to 50,000 people. In our IT, is roughly 10% of our staff. To get an idea, 3,000 IT, we have IBM mainframes, we have HP nonstop, we have Windows, we have Linux, a bit of AIX, and we are highly virtualized. To get an idea. So, you saw that in the Microsoft presentation, and my presentation from a strategic point of view and trends isn't different. We see the customers are getting digital. They demand everything fast. Not now, but earlier than now. They want to be helped. They don't even want to ask questions. They want to be helped before they know they have a problem. You see a lot of fintechs aiming at our customers, which is a big issue for us as banks. We see it as a big competition. We have still a weak economy. The banks are under pressure by regulators. Costs lots of money to present all the right figures to be compliant in that space. And we see a lot of criminal attacks. Our strategy is to have customers in the first place. We want, in the Netherlands, it's a 9+ customer experience would be related to an A- customer experience. We are aiming high. It needs to be personalized. And it needs to be omni-channel. We saw that yesterday in the presentations. Rabobank isn't different. We want to have our products seamlessly available across all platforms. And actually, we are quite ahead in that, I guess. While lowering cost, gaining in volume, because the business letting go of 25,000 people has to be solved for parts of the problem by more IT in the end. More straight-through processes. I'm losing my... Okay. And so IT has to step up there. Volumes are getting higher, and also we get a target of losing people. I think it will not be 25%. It's been figured out at this moment, but we expect between 15 and 20% losing people, gaining volume, and adding more IT to the business. While having more rapid change, not everywhere. We are not doing agile and DevOps across the line. We have what the Gartners and IBMs call bimodal IT or TOR2 speed IT and that kind of stuff. I will come back to it later. But actually, within Rabobank, we call it 50 shades of DevOps. So what's the key message? To have a customer experience that's A-, we need to be always available. So continuity is high. We need an improved time to market. So yes, we are going to do continuous releasing. Yes, development and delivery of processes needs to be highly automated. We have bringing automated testing and test analysis. And we need loosely coupled modular IT. What do we mean with that? Think about an API-driven model where the API talks to another API. And that's the basic model of IT. What you do underneath that API isn't that important, but as long as the API is consistent and working. So a real service and oriented architecture as we know it for years. While a culture has to be highly agile. The upper side of this model is our old IT value stream model we used at Rabobank. You see a demand coming in for a strategy, moving through development into IT operations. Underneath, it's mapped to the IT4IT stuff, which we are bringing in at this moment. We can overlap that straight away. It's the same. In the end, it's the same model, just written down, I think, nicer today. It's a nicer model. And we can put our strategy across it also. At the left side, strategy to portfolio, you have to know what to build. Prioritize with business aligned. What does the business want to do? Actually, we are not so good at this. Then, automate everything. And why aren't we so good at this? We had too much money in the end. We had never had any governance help in the Netherlands while our competition had. We always were in the black figures, and that. And you see that changing now because there is a cost pressure today. Still making profit, but we suspect going into the future that we need to cut costs and that there is real pressure from the board on this issue. And that really helps to automate everything. We are moving fast in that direction. And I think it will help to put pressure on strategy to portfolio as well. Monitor everything, run seamlessly based on a fundamental modular IT. Our upside is very mature, I might say. Very, very mature. We are looking at the next thing of analytics to really prevent outages. Not by looking for events we already know, because that's already automated at Rabobank. Whole incident process is automated. Detect to correct in the end is automated at Rabobank. We are beyond that. So the big focus at now in this day and age at Rabobank is in dev. Automate dev as much as possible. What needs to be done? Across Rabobank, a common understanding of loosely coupled IT. How does the model, what is the model, what does it look like, and everybody has to work with the same model. Move away from silos. And saying that always is difficult because moving away from one silo creates a new silo. We moved away from infrastructure-based silos, testing silos, monitoring silos, into business value chain silos. But in the end, they are silos. New silos, more business-driven, so that's good. But still, silos, and you have to overarch those silos. Because there isn't, if you have a group responsible for all mobile banking, they have, in the end, to bring payments into that mobile banking side, and payments is a different part of the organization. We need an agile culture. not everybody working agile straight away. So waterfall is still good if you have a mainframe which is updated every once every year, and you've been doing that for 25 years. It's not really feasible or needed to go into an agile approach there. But the culture has to be agile. You have to be customer aware, lean and agile. Customer aware. You have to move fast. You can the automations you develop are also good in a waterfall method. It will show value. That leaves us in a maturity model. And I know within the group there's a lot of debate to create one for IT4IT. I love to see one, but we in between we did this because we couldn't wait. In the end, we want to the aim is loosely coupled IT, DevOps, seamless automation, everything automated, everything agile, and preventive analysis. In the end, we want to have seamless IT, fully automated across the board. To get there, you have a few streams who will help you there with certain steps in between. I think you will get the slide, so I think I will not go into every detail here, but you can look it up. What we see as in-between steps that show value in itself. We actually look for steps that in itself already show value. So why a value stream-based approach? We want the ability to track cost, performance, business value, and risk as a base of investment and improvement decisions from requirement to retirement. IT isn't ops. IT isn't dev. IT is the support, in our case, of doing a payment on a mobile a telephone. That's our business. To do a loan, to help the advice of our local branches. That's our IT. That's what it needs to support. So we have to be able to track the cost of that kind of transactions so that we can make a decision whether for Rabobank it's good to stay in a certain country doing direct banking or something like that. That type of cost. Today, that's not possible. And I will challenge every bank that says they can, because we can't. And I think the competition in the Netherlands, we have great talks with them. They all can't have, yes, they make a price per transaction, but it's this way. So you have to understand the value chain in IT, so everybody understands it. Architects, management, so we can make same decisions where to invest. Why? Because in the IT, in the end, IT is not different from any other industry, only less mature than a few of us. So our approach is governance by principle. Our architecture is a principle-based architecture. I have slides with a lot of data on it. You will see it, but it's based on just principle-based architecture. Why? We trust our people, and we want to trust our people that they will do the right thing in the end. So less control. We are diminishing controls. Yes, we need to be compliant. So those are critical controls, but in the end, all in between steps we did with ITIL, we brought in with ITIL, and we are still an ITIL-based company that won't change. An incident is still an incident, a problem is still a problem, a change is still a change. But how you look at it and how you manage those processes, because it's not about counting incidents. In the end, it's about availability of a business server to a customer. And we have to understand that, and that's the value. And again, that's the value stream. So, and we want to trust our people to doing the right, making the right choices. So we set some boundaries, we set some guidelines, and that's our principle-based architecture. You will see things there as reuse before buy before build, single source because you need one truth, simplicity. I heard it with Microsoft as well. Same, it's roughly the same thing, and in terminology, everybody can understand, and they are starting to live within Rabobank. So if we already have a solution for something, everybody knows that they have to explain something if they want something else. They really start to understand that. your agile way of working, you see the operational principles derived from the business principles as well. Avoid handoff, create everything from self-service, loosely couple, size is a challenge, so you need structure. Yes, there needs to be structure. Everything needs to be automated, that kind of principle, so that everybody really can understand. And actually that helps. So what have we implemented? The 50 shades of DevOps. Again, the same model. That's what we have in place. It's been there. The upper side of this model has been there now, I think, 10 years. We're using it for 10 years. The only thing I added, I think, 5 years ago, were the orange arrows coming back. That's what when we started to introduce Lean and Agile. And that the loop back became more interesting. But in the end, everybody who there's a great discussion, and everybody who wants to debate that with me. We have a lot of debate that agile and architecture that's a big change. In my opinion, nothing changes. Only the speed of things. You still need your PSAs, your architecture for your projects. You still need the same things, but you create them in a different timeline. So, maybe good for debate later on whether agile or lean changes the way we do architecture. Again, the same, changing it to the IT4IT model. We actually implemented version 1.1. That at that time wasn't on the market, we would say. But still, it helps us. Why does it help us? We map, like Microsoft also suggested, we map our solutions against it. With one idea, the essence is one function, one tool at Rabobank. Do we actually implement one function, one tool? No, we do a stack-based approach. We have a big Java environment, a big Microsoft environment, Microsoft.net environment is managed by Microsoft stuff, the Java with the Java community stuff, SAP with the SAP stuff, Oracle with the Oracle stuff, HP with the HP, and the overarching part we do with HP. So required to deploy, again, the same tools, same basic approach, and it really helps you. You get an insight straight away whether it's too much or too little or whatever. You get the slide. So if I'm not too fast and the picture isn't taken yet, you can look it up in the slides. And then one part that I a bit miss in today's IT for IT framework, documentation, task execution like batch and that kind of stuff. Where do you position it in today's architecture? That are things I think that can be debated out, and still is ops. The reporting layer, test data management configure. You can argue that you can place test data management, but you also can argue that it's not really finding a place. Config management, sort of, in the end, I miss a fundamental layer of real fundamentals, models, objects, that kind of stuff. What are the results we find today? We are consolidating tools fast because we have insight in which tools we use. And actually, we started off roughly around the mid-90s with automating the incident process, automating service management processes as well. And for that, we needed to consolidate our, at that time, 8 service management solutions into the one we have today. The idea is to get one tool for every function in the end. The industry has to be standardized as well to do so. Because today you really need a community-based approach. Microsoft still has trouble managing Java, and Java environment still has troubles managing a Microsoft platform. And in the end, I really want one solution for every function. So for the people from the industry here, build those solutions. But in the end, you also need one common data model. That's a question, again, to the open group. come up with one common IT data model. Give it to me. I need it straight. And then de facto, you create the market standard. One common service model across all industry. I love it. Give it. So what we have also today is multidisciplinary scrum teams in Dev and Ops. Still experimenting whether we do it with leadership only across DevOps, or people in one DevOps team, or still a Dev and an Ops team, and all kinds of in-betweens there. Still separation of concerns because it's needed in a bank, but changing fast, because if you have automated Dev to Ops procedures, you have straight through compliance as well. If there is no people involved, you don't have separation of concern. You don't need separation of concern. You just give the ops guy the key. VP level management, still dev and ops, but experimenting, said it. Deliberately not everything agile. Why? I addressed it earlier. Because a mainframe is a total different thing than our portals or our mobiles. Automating fast, instant process, fully automated, event management fully automated, delivery of a normal Linux or Microsoft service fully, server fully automated, actually automating middleware as well, like MQ, which is a hazard. But automating their deployment of server of software, automating. So it's really adopting fast. And yes, I hear what the Microsoft team was telling earlier, that the people have to really start feel the change. We started this journey I think 10 years ago, and only have the last 2 years really increase in speed in automating. People have to be under pressure to start automating. They see everything happening at the bank. They see their colleagues gone, because today it's 25% of our people, but last year we also had had to lose 20% of our people. So it's counting and counting, and then there's pressure on the people, and you see then everything gets fluid, and we automate really fast, because then the people get a motivation to automate. Value we got. A value-based approach gives me the opportunity to tell my leadership where to invest. I can now pinpoint, for instance, our detect-to-correct site is very mature, so please go into Dev and invest there to automate more there, because it's feasible, and then you get a total maturity level of your IT organization pushed up. The real discussion now is we started to automate IT functions like detect to correct, like delivery of required to deploy, that kind of stuff. But now the questions come up. If I need a new mobile payment, I want to automate along those lines. So a new portal, so business-wise. So we have the models in place, there. And automation, we actually really see our time to market stepping up fast, less cost to deploy, actually also more change. So we are getting there with continuous delivery. The challenges. Still, the business finds it hard that IT demands time and money for itself to implement the change, to automate, because it's a cost that goes before the benefit. So you have to fight for your priorities. The common architecture is also, today, is still silo-based. Yes, we have service-oriented architecture, but it's not mature enough to really automate across those lines. Impact on operations is high when work is automated. Microsoft also stated this, and it really is. We need different people. In the end, yes, we are going to lose a few people, but in the end, it's about changing the way we work. And our suspicion is that we will have to lose roughly 20 to 30% of the people who can't move into a more solution-based approach, scripting, understanding the process of the way they work, and starting to be able to help automate those processes, and still trying to go into the systems and that kind of stuff. Those people won't keep up. Our culture today is not yet agile and not yet risk-aware enough. So if you give the responsibility to the people, then you have to be sure that they know what they're doing. And we have a leadership issue, because we have organized across business domains. So who, in the end, is boss of IT? We have infrastructure, we have one boss, we have payments and loans and finance and organization, that kind of stuff, in different domains. So who is going to determine where the buck for operations will go? That's a big challenge, actually, because in the end, it will help you be efficient, because in certain areas, they will implement their own solutions. And then, as an because I'm an architect for all of it, for all IT management across this platform, I will have a debate with those VPs who actually then have to report to me why they chose different solutions. But in the end, they can, because they have the money. What is the current tool set is not sufficient. Sprawl of tools, continuity. It's closely related to a remark I made earlier. If we don't have clear integrations between steps in the process, clear APIs, you will have vendors not integrating automatically. And I think we all can recognize that. A Microsoft tool set doesn't automatically integrate with an HP tool set or an IBM tool set. I think if the industry will, it would be my position that if the industry will mature and wants to mature, this needs to change. So we have to have some common ground rules about service model within, maybe really, and I think this is a good start to have this as a basis to move ahead on this. And so I hope the industry also will recognize that and will work with Open Group to develop this further. And that gives me time for questions.
We do questions. If we can just say,
are there any questions from the audience? I think there's some coming around. Yeah, so we're going to do it. If I can invite you to have a seat, pick up which way you sit, and we'll sit. But we do have a few questions from the audience, and obviously we're going to have more questions for the panel. But people won't get to ask you those questions, so. Yeah, Dave, sure. Thank you. So while we get going on those, just one of the things that struck me about what you said a lot about people having to, loosening controls on people, giving them certain boundaries and guidelines, but trusting them to do the right thing and make the right decisions. Give an example of the kind of area that happens and where it's worked and where it hasn't, or is it too early to say?
No, it's not too early to say. We give, based on the agile approach, we give the teams all freedom within their teams to choose which every method they want to choose amongst the team, every tool they want to use, as long as it's not related to Rabobank standards in the end. So we have a cross team approach, for instance, your source control and that kind of stuff. That's where we demand to use certain solutions. So that's where we gave more freedom. We're also looking to give me more freedom in change control, for instance. It's a very rigorous process today at Rabobank, costing a lot of time. So why not trust people that they really will do the testing, they really will understand the impact that their change will have on multiple environments. So that kind of areas.
And are they responding well?
It's kind of difficult because they always were used in a bank with high compliance. They get freedom. Freedom. The dev side already always took that freedom, but the upside is it's a culture shock.
Yeah. I bet. Okay, we've got some questions from the audience, which Open Group CTO Dave Lounsbury will start asking. Over to you, Dave.
Yeah. Thank you, Steve. You mentioned that your incidents were fully automated, and how do you do it, and what does that mean in practice for your IT and operational staff?
How do we do it? It's a big, it's a long story. I can go about it, I think, for another 2 hours. In the end, it's event management, really doing, knowing what what's being put in your logs, as well as measuring the infrastructure, correlating it very, very well and very rigorously, and creating incidents from that, and automated workflows as well to assign incidents, to mitigate incidents. And
okay, great. So another question. What do you mean by two speeds of IT? How does that? How do you map that out? Or your 50 shades of DevOps?
Yeah, it's everything between a fully agile, a highly free, all degrees of freedom, to a fully waterfall-based approach, and everything in between, with a dev, with real separation of concerns, to total teams of dev and ops doing, for instance, and we try that with dev having in the standby cycles, so they understand what hazard they put on ops, that kind of stuff. And in the end, also leaving nothing, leave everything the way it is, only adding automation, for instance, in the mainframe area.
Great, thank you. There are a lot of existing standards for IT service management out there, a lot of frameworks. What areas have you found there to be gaps in those, and where do you see IT4IT filling some of those in?
I think IT4IT gives the architectural framework, where we always have been using ITIL as one of the first, actually, in Europe. We adopted that. And you heard in my bio, I have a big history in ITIL, and I always found we were over-ITILized at Rabobank. Because actually, these are real examples that I mentioned. It's not about counting incidents. And I still say at the Rabobank, it's not about counting incidents. It's about availability of business servers.
So, thank you. Steve, we got two more. How are we doing on time?
We're okay for... Yeah, we maybe can't. They're completely different. Take two more, Dave.
Okay, great. So you mentioned needing to avoid money in the business, and does that result? Do you feel that it results in short-term decision making or a trade-off between short-term and long-term?
How do I? Can you explain the question?
Well, I might have to invite the person who submitted it. Yeah, Eric. Here, I'll walk around. Oh, great.
In the past, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. In the past, money in the business means local decisions and mess in the near future. See what I mean? If everybody is choosing, if the business is choosing what they expect the best for the business,
yeah,
it may mean that in the near future you have to manage a messy situation. So do you consider it's you can manage that?
Yeah, that's true. In the end, you have a lot of debate always about in the industry about IT being the business. In my opinion, IT still is an enabler of business and still isn't business. We are doing payments and loans in the end. And if we can do it cheaper tomorrow by using paper, we will go back to paper and not IT. But the business really understands the value of IT in the business process of a bank, and actually they demand more IT at Rabobank. All business processes as much as possible automated as well. So the strategy of having automation in IT is not only in IT, it's also having automation in business.
Okay, thank you.
And that for a bank, for traditional old bank, that's also a cultural shock.
So just one last one, which I'll turn into a statement. You know, you called for the interoperability of the development of a common model for information sharing across all those phases and interoperability tools to do that. That's something where I think the Open Group would love to step up to that challenge, but we always like to have both the buyer and the supplier represented. So if Rabobank wants to get involved in leading that, please come and see us.
Maybe show of hands, who wants that kind of model?
Okay.
Yeah.
So there's
not
a group
even
already.
As much as I expected. So.
Thank you.
Group
Thank
already you. Forming. But anyway, big round of applause for Toine. Thank you very much, Toine. Thank you.